Hi everyone, welcome back to my channel. In this video, I want to present for you a brief information about the Canaanite Pantheon of Gods. Canaan was a region that located in today's Israel, Western Jordan, Syria, and Lebanon. The Canaanites were a Semitic-speaking civilization in the ancient Near East. The people in this region believed in many gods. They practiced polytheism, while some of them, like the ancient Hebrews, practiced monotheism. The ancient Hebrews were considered Canaanites before they accepted and invented their new religion. Canaanite religion was influenced by their neighbors, like the Hurrians, Hittites, Mesopotamians, and Egyptians. The people who lived in coastal cities produced and traded a special purple color from the murex shell, and later on were called Phoenicians by the Greeks. The Greeks called the coastal Canaanites Phoenician from the word phoenix, which means crimson or purple. Phoenician and Canaanite refer to the same culture. Archaeologists and historians commonly refer to the Bronze Age Levantines as Canaanites and their Iron Age descendants as Phoenicians. The information about the Canaanite religion is from the Ugaritic texts that were found in northern Syria in 1929. The main stories of the Ugarit texts are the Baal cycle, the legend of Keret, and the tale of Akkad, written in Northwest Semitic language. Now let's talk about the main deities of the Canaanite Pantheon. So the main deities of the Canaanite Pantheon are El and Asherah. They're considered to be the parents of all the gods. For the Canaanites and the ancient Levantine region as a whole, El was the supreme god, the father of mankind and all creatures. He is the creator god, father of all the gods and father of time. He described as having gray long beard. He is full of wisdom and he's called Toru El, the bull god. Bulls are his sacred animal. He's also called the merciful god. El fathered many gods and most importantly Baal, Hadad, Yam and Mot. In the Baal cycle, El is introduced dwelling on Mount Lel at the fountains of the two rivers at the spring of the two deeps. One of El's epithets is El Elyon, which translates to High God or the Most High. We find the same name of El Elyon describing Yahweh in the Bible. For those who are a bit confused, Yahweh is not the Canaanite god El. The writers of the Bible used El epithet to describe their own god Yahweh as the Most High. The writers of the Bible were influenced by the Canaanite god El and the Canaanite religion overall. El is also the god of magic and he can cure diseases. So mainly the god El is the creator of all the animals, of all humankind, and he is father god. He is the most supreme god in the ancient Near East, in the Levantine region, and he was the authoritative god. He's also described as the god of justice and the god of oaths. His wife is the goddess Asherah, and they have 70 divine gods together. In the Baal cycle, the god El is favoring his son Yam to be the ruler of the gods. But afterwards, that he understands that Baal is the most appropriate god to rule, he actually grieving Baal when Baal is dying and going to the underworld. And when Baal is coming back at autumn, El is rejoicing and making him the king of the gods. So now let's talk about the great goddess Asherah. Goddess Asherah is the wife of the supreme god El. She is the mother goddess, and she is the mother of all the gods. She has 70 or 88 divine children. She described as the lady of the sea, she is mother earth and sea. Sea and earth are the elements of the divine feminine. She is the goddess of motherhood and fertility and childbirth. In the Baal cycle, Asherah suggesting that her son Atar will be the king of the gods. But she helps Baal to receive permission to build his palace. Asherah states that Baal is the one who knows how to rule and he should be the king of the gods. In the tale of Karat, the hero of the story forgets to offer a sacrifice to the goddess. And he's not fulfilling his oath that he's promised to the goddess. So the goddess Asherah punished him by having a lethal disease. The cult of Asherah was practiced in Jerusalem until her worship was destroyed by the Hebrews. Her altar was actually beside Yahweh altar, and it is estimated that her worship and her altar was in Jerusalem for about 300 years. The women of Israel worshipped Asherah in their homes, and they gave her offerings. Asherah was the goddess who protected women, and she ruled all the subjects that were concerning women. She represented the tree of life, and tree groves and hilltops were sacred to her. Sometimes she is synchronized or conflated with the goddess Astarte. But Asherah is a more of a mother goddess. She is more mature. She is the mother of all the gods, while Astarte is a young aspect of this goddess, we can say. And Astarte represents the young, beautiful woman who is seducing or attracting her partner, and she represents the spark of life. Well, Asherah is more mature and old goddess. Let's talk about the goddess Astarte. Astarte is the daughter of El and Asherah. She is the goddess of love, of beauty, of war, and hunting. Goddess Astarte is the consort of god Baal, and she's the daughter of El and Asherah. She is sometimes conflated with the goddess Asherah. Asherah is a more motherly goddess, while Astarte is the younger desire and the spark of life. She is a protective goddess that described as a lioness. As the goddess of the hunt, she provides abundance and prosperity. Astarte is the goddess of victory as well, mistress of magic and healing. In the Baal cycle, she rebukes Baal for not being fair with the captive god Yam. She also holds Baal's hand with her sister Anat so he will not strike the messengers of Yam. So Astarte is also associated with justice and fairness. She is a protective goddess that used to protect homes and entryways. Astarte is sometimes associated with the goddess Ishtar, Inanna, Aphrodite, which in my opinion is the same energy and the same frequency. But this is just my opinion. So now let's talk about the goddess Anat. Anat is a major goddess. There is a lot of information about her, and in this brief video, I cannot put all the information. I will have to do a separate video for this goddess. But briefly, she is a major goddess. She is the goddess of war. She is the daughter of El and Asherah. She is the sister of Astarte, of Baal, of Yam and Mot. In the Baal cycle, she is basically helping Baal to receive his power. She intervenes on behalf of Baal, so he will have a permission to build his palace. She is helping him to defeat his enemies. She's always by his side. When Baal is going to the underworld, Anat is mourning him and she's looking for him. and eventually she is killing Mot, who is the god of the dead. So she described as a virgin goddess. She do not have a partner. She is a sort of a tomboy, a warrior goddess. She's very independent, very powerful, and she's always helping her brother Baal, because he represents the order, he represents the good force, the forces of life. So she's always standing by his side. She is also not afraid of her father El. She is disrespectfully coming to his palace and demands that he will give a permission to Baal to build his palace. Basically, she is a very fierce, goal-oriented goddess. She is also described as the goddess of the hunt. And her relationship with Baal is a matter of dispute, because she is represented as a virgin goddess, a goddess that is independent, that do not have any consort. But on the other side, there are texts that she is having love relationship with Baal, and she also represents the aspect of fertility. Also, the goddess Anat is represented as the patroness of people and the one who cares about human beings, and she also killing all the haters and all the enemies of Baal. Now let's talk about the major god Baal. Baal is the king of the gods, is the most important deity and god in the ancient Near East, in the Levant. He was worshipped in Mesopotamia. He was worshipped in Anatolia, in Syria, in Canaan. He was the most important deity. God Baal is the god of fertility, of weather, of rain, of wind, lightning, seasons. He's the god of sailors and the god of war. He is represented as a mighty warrior, and he is defeating all of his enemies. So basically, the Ugaritic texts are all about the hero Baal. He's the most important deity in the text, and also is the most important god in the ancient Near East, and he is the king of the gods. The god El is already old, and he's not capable of being the king of the gods, so he needs to give his kingdom to one of his sons. And at the beginning, the god El is plotting even against Baal, and he wants to give his kingdom to the god Yam, which is the god of the sea. But eventually, god Baal is going into battle with the god Yam, and Baal is winning. So Baal is the most strongest god. He's the one who knows how to rule, and he's the one that's supposed to rule. No one can beat him. The god Baal also represents life itself, the cycle of life, the changing of the seasons, and he also a god that is dying and resurrecting again. He's going to the underworld, and he's rising up again. As the seasons are changing, so God Baal is also changing with the season. He represents the rain and the fertile aspect of existence. In summer, he's challenged by the god of the dead, which is Mot, and Baal is going into the underworld. So there is a lot of mystical meaning in the story of Baal. I will dive deep into all of those stories in my next videos. And also something very interesting that I have found is that the ancient Hebrews prophets, they had a major problem with the god Baal. So the writers of the Bible, they disliked the cult of the god Baal, because obviously the god Baal was the most powerful of the ancient Near East. He was the major deity, and he have a lot of power in him. He represents a lot of power. He's the king of the gods. And suddenly, the ancient Hebrews have a new god, they have a new cult, and the writers of the Bible took some characteristics that Baal have, and they put those characteristics into the god Yahweh. So the god Yahweh also is described as riding on the clouds. The god Yahweh is fighting with Leviathan, which is a sea god, sea monster. And also the Jewish holidays of Rosh Hashanah and Sukkot are based on ancient pagan rituals that were worshipped and celebrated in autumn for the resurrection of Baal. So there is a lot of synchronicity and a lot of similarity. They are not the same. I will talk about it in a different video, but there is a lot of similarity. So basically, the god Baal is the most important god. He is the king of the gods, and a lot of Yahweh attributes and characteristics are stolen from god Baal. But as we know, Baal have many enemies, he have many haters, and it seems like Yahweh is again one of Baal's enemies. And as we know in the story and in the myth of Baal, Baal is always winning. So this is a very interesting situation. Baal is also, of course, a god of fertility. He is a god that prolongs life. He is the god of procreation. He is the god that gives lives. And he represents order, good forces, and the energy of life. So there is a lot of mystical meanings in the stories of Baal. I will dive into this in later videos. So for now, I think this is enough to describe the major king of the gods.